seven that Mark was hired.
You got a civil?
Yeah, yeah.
You gonna buy this out before you put it away?
What's that?
You gonna buy this out before you put it away?
I hear that all the time, like everybody I know is like, hey man, we're gonna go out and go out and go.
We're gonna license captain, let's go.
Oh yeah?
Yeah.
Alright. They gotta be up by October 1st, so we don't have that much. Anything else? Anything exciting? Alright, well, what's the Kanye song or whatever, like we always do at this time? Yeah, we're gonna get into groups. No, do groups of four, and then one group of half out. And talk a little bit about kingdom rights. Did anybody pre-order the iPhone? Yeah, I did. Oh, what size? Oh, what size? I got the 256 and it said November, like middle of November. Then a jet black.
Thank you. Oh my god, my friend, I don't know if he's ethics right now, he's like texting me like,
So my question is, have anybody else been pulled over in the force? Yeah, and I just find it to be weird that I know a couple of people when I was a student too, they got pulled over because they don't know where else the people that live in this But if you have any other like issues like that, you know, let me know. I'll take it to Dean Kersey, go take it to the president, and we can go talk to the police manager. Just say, hey, you gotta stop harassing me without a reason. Was it relevant to human rights, right? Discrimination over time. All right.
Thank you. Strong, trustworthy, and charitable. That is the one I want.
Did anyone else have any questions about the case? I really want this issue.
provide internship opportunities in Northwestern.
Those internships paid?
Yes, they are.
It's commission based. So is it?
As to representative.
There's no standard.
What do you mean by standard?
No.
Like base rate?
So you can. You can take kind of everything, so like your activity, how much you want to meet with. You go to training sessions, like every Friday, every Friday, and then you go to different ones, so you get paid to both things. So you get paid, it's not just commission.
It's not hourly?
Yes. Some parts of it are, so like the training part of it.
Who's a big part?
I'm not saying.
You got it before.
Yes. I know that you did it, and I told Nicole you were in the class, and I was like, you were just happy.
Yeah, he didn't want it.
Oh, okay.
Totally unrelated to my class. Related to the United Nations, she's an ambassador of the United Nations.
Oh, that's true.
Does anybody actually have a job waiting for them, like when they want to finish school?
Yeah. So this is just really to give everyone an idea to say, hey, look at everybody's different perspectives on how they would look at ethics or how they perceive ethics. So you guys could. So we see that the role that they should take is pretty much to create a safe environment that they should kind of be active in where they're working.
On all levels, even if this is a dangerous job, safe instruction.
I think that regardless, you should be working, like looking out for the people that you're working with, regardless of whether they're from your home country or not. I think it's kind of your responsibility as a human being to watch out for other people. It shouldn't matter where you're from.
Okay.
So I think regardless of the industry, you should be trying to create safe environments and not just do whatever it is that makes life cheaper. We also said that it's, the case talks about it being a little bit more than just profits, that a company should be working towards being ethically, and the out, if they put in that in, that input, then the outcome will be that they'll gain profits regardless.
So there's a benefit.
Yeah, regardless. It'll be something that they get out of it. And then we talked about how they should enhance human dignity. So their role towards human rights issues is that they should be considering the person as an actual person, and not just as someone that's doing this to them, but they should be creating a good environment for that person and having them grow within the same company, regardless
of their role. As a moment with bigger potential, so it's probably existence.
And this is some of the major concerns were child labor, quality of life, low wages.
Are you against child labor? Are you guys against child labor?
Yes.
Or is it just a pen?
No,
or?
I think a child should have the opportunity to get a basic education and so forth, whatever age that is required for him.
So that requirement is set in place by the country. For example, let's say India. Yeah, I mean, we can say the United States, but 50 states made up of 50 different government bodies, right? And even more than that, Puerto Rico is small. And so each state, you cross state lines, so I have firearms, right? So I carry a gun. If I go to Wisconsin and there's a new law there, I just crossed the border, I'm going to get arrested if I didn't follow protocol. Or you want to date someone, right? You say, oh, well, they're of a younger age, but respected 50, like in Louisiana, it used to be 14. I don't know if it is now, I think it may be 16. No, no, it's 18, right? So you guys say, even here in the United States, how complex this perception of youth, age, things like that. So with child labor, what do you consider to be too bad?
You mean below 15.
So 15 years old? You guys feel different? Okay.
I mean, if you have a permit, like, if you're 13 or 14 and you're living in Chicago, like, a working permit, I mean, it's like, plus a circumstance, but even that's available. I don't know.
Yeah, no, in Europe now, most countries in Europe, you can train at, what's it, 16? 16?
I think it's, 17.
17. Yeah, here, but it's just something to think about. To say like, hey, you know, this is totally different cultural environment. They don't see things the way we see them. And somebody have a question?
I was going to say that they're saying that in certain places like India, child labor is actually seen as a good thing. Like, the kids don't help off their families by working, they don't get used to it. They pretty much support their families. They're working as young as 80 or 90 years old in some circumstances. And just, you know, in some cultures, that's not necessarily seen as like slave labor or whatnot. It's actually just a normal part of culture.
It could be seen as being responsible or disciplined or developing characteristics that will make it a better adult.
But don't we have, like, countries have kind of responsibility to help countries that aren't as developed
as other countries are. So I'm going to be concerned with companies that allow child labor, that it's regulated, and they provide education to these students or whatever, whatever, or the development of the country as a whole, not just like using that. I mean, that's true, but the thing to consider, so this class focuses on, hey, well, you're a manager, CEO in the United States, and you're developing people across the border. And across the border may not be the United States, North America, and Europe, which is considered the Western thought perception. Right? So everything outside of that is something completely different from the godliness tradition. So do we say, are we encroaching a Western democratic perspective on people's cultures, trying to make them be what we think is the right thing? And that's what I'm saying, it's a complex thing. There is no universal answer to this. But this is just something that's kind of see the different perspective of what else?
We talked about ideas to deal with the problems, and we talked about inclusive businesses, ethical decision making, and sustainable businesses. So when we say inclusive businesses, kind of going off with what Maddie was saying, that kind of having them do something within the communities that they're working with, so giving them children education if they're going to actually participate in child labor. And then the role of the corporate code of conduct, he said that it should pretty much keep them on track of whatever their mission is and what their goal is, and it should help hold them accountable for what their decisions are.
Okay. So it really just depends on companies' code of conduct and how they want to do business and what they choose to do.
We had said about the human race that corporations are responsible to adapt to each different country because no country is the same, because no person is the same. But it's no, it's acceptable there, like maybe child labor is acceptable there. Like that's the only way, and that's the only outcome that like, income you might have. Mm-hmm. So taking that away from them, like, directing people to other ways, maybe to get money, which is not as good as actually working. You're saying just adapt to like each different country, and I think that's your responsibility to know what your country wants and what you accept.
So, you're saying child labor, you shouldn't get as a company, right? Because that's a system in place there, and that system exists for a reason.
Yeah.
That's what it does, what it means, right? So, a system exists maybe because people are economically poor,
yeah.
And they need as many people in their household. Help them survive and live, to have an opportunity, have a better life.
Yeah.
Or most children could be kind of thrown away in that country. So there could be issues with child abuse. Therefore, these kids are homeless. What can they do? Just play all day or not? They need to find a way to actually live. So most of these kids around the world, in developing countries, they're homeless. Or they're not taking care of themselves, they don't take care of themselves.
Yeah, and then you just come in and say, oh, no more child labor law. You're getting rid of all these jobs for these kids and like, what to do, what to do.
Yeah.
They said that you're playing on day, especially with the college.
So not doing that has more of a negative impact than a positive.
Yeah, okay. And then for the human rights concerns, I'd say we talked about child labor, unfavorable conditions. Low wages. Then I think maybe it's just remaining aware of what the problems are. That's like the first step towards changing the responsible corporation. Being aware that there is a problem. And it's the role that the company has being socially responsible and being accountable for the employees in that country. And really missing any of the way break the law in that country, the company should be able to be accountable for not.
So your code of conduct is written in corporate policy. We adapt to other people's cultures. We work with them. We don't pressure them to take on their ideologies and beliefs. But with that being said, maybe there's some things we don't go beyond. We draw the line on certain issues. Just say, you know, safe working conditions, a fair wage relative to whatever is cost of living.
I had the same problems we've seen, child labor, inadequate pay, long hours, dangerous working conditions. As far as how multinational corporations should deal with it, we're kind of foreign in some cases, so as far as like child labor, my first idea was to, you know, try to deal with those things, but sometimes you don't want to, you know, interfere with other cultures by, like you said. instead of imposing your Western philosophy on them. Mm-hmm. So I guess what we would do is, you know, kind of, child labor is a hard issue. As far as the other issues that they had, they had long hours and everything, you're saying multinational corporations could offer their foreign workers the same types of benefits and pay as they do their local workers. And they, since they have a huge, presence and power with all their money, so they would try to lobby for change a little more successfully than normal people could. So, try and get into a political system and form a people to start change.
So similar to them, the dad, all the stuff with doctors, start working conditions, and then go in from the top. So funnel money in from the top to lobby so that the government changes the systems and the structures. What's the question?
These are good ideas. But it really doesn't happen, right? If they go overseas to cut costs instead of keeping costs high.
Well, I mean, that's the nature of what we define ethics, define morals.
I mean, define if they want to give these child laborers higher wages, why would they say, America?
Higher wages for them is significantly still lower than 10, 12, 15, 20, $25 an hour. I mean, we're still talking low to the dollar, we're talking 80 cents an hour. So it's still going to always be, and that might be like, hey, I could pay $1.25 an hour, this is awesome, I make the most of my neighborhood. So you're still being good on that end, but the point is you have to set what is it you're all about as a company. Are you actually about doing good stuff and making money? Or are you all about money? Because if it's all about money, you have to think, well, what's the corporate culture back home in the States? It's all about money, then, I care about you, you're just a unit, you're fired, you don't do your job, you're not paying your money, and that's it. And then that translates over to the other country. You can absolutely care less about them because they're not even here. You probably give them an aggregate spread as a country, but smaller, that's kind of big, et cetera, et cetera. So the point is, you have to create to say, hey, what is our policy? Where do we have an ethics code of conduct? Do we have a moral code? What is the definition of these things? And from there, you can say, hey, you know what? We do. And we can make a lot more money if we start doing good things and market those good things so that people can see and say, I want to be affiliated with that company and look at all the great stuff they do. Not just like, hey, we're the best finance company in the world. You got to do all this stuff too. That's what I want. But it's complex, because many successful companies don't have ethics, especially the international companies. Particularly, manufacturing, so most of the clothes are wearing tags, no manual tags, etc. And now it's starting to get to my turn. You can see how this stuff changes if you're reading it, if you see how it goes. We talk a lot more about Perkins because we're doing way more business with them. Now you're closer to the name of Perkins instead of China. Right? China's moving away, people want more money there, better conditions, all the spotlight is there. No, let's go over the spotlight stuff. But that's the thing. Define ethics, define morals, and it probably changes from everybody's religious beliefs, family, et cetera. What's next?
What else do you want?
Here we go.
On the market, we kind of talked about the role. We put awareness and learning that's going on. We also said not to make it worse and not to make it worse. And what are we doing? We also said
you're aware. Like, hey, we've run all the data here, this is how the average cost of living, this is what people know what they're paying to do this specific job, we see what's going on politically, socially, we know it's happening,
they're saying just be aware, but maybe not act on it, just know it exists, maybe turn on the TV or something.
Yeah. Well, some of the sensors are powered, they have the money and resources to do, they have the money and resources to kind of make anything happen, so it's just going to make it happen.
Through what use of like the government? Or like advertising or start a program or whatever?
Well, yeah, that's kind of what I was saying, like, just, start a program.
For social program.
Yeah. But some of the concerns for Sierra Leone are because of child labor, foot traps, punishment, and failure. Going along with the solution then, we kind of start like, through the strong and accessible agency. And then we also said developing social programs and to practice what you teach.
Nice. Like I said, guys, I mean, this is a very complex issue. The companies have trying to identify ethics, morals, put it into a corporate policy to follow so that they don't follow. When you start a multinational corporation, you just proceed to take that away. So you play ball, halfway. You work with people, but you also get drive. And if there's nothing illegal, whatever it is you're doing, it's not out of illegal rest. The point of this is to see human rights. Is there a such thing as human rights? Yes? By the UN, same thing. According to the United Nations, perhaps is everyone familiar with the United Nations?
Yes.
There are over 200 countries, United Nations, everybody votes, come to a consensus, and adopt and enact procedures and agreements, etc. And those are the fundamental freedoms. What do you think human beings should have as freedom? Universal. Anybody?
Wall.
Basic nutrition, water and food. People shouldn't just be allowed to die. Right? Just can't access water and food. That's probably the most basic. Nothing else matters. What other? Education? So freedom to learn. We don't want people to be restricted to say, like, hey, you can't learn that. It's against the law. You can't read that book. You can't read that book. You can't access that.
What is safety?
Safety. So safe in our homes, safe in the streets, safe in what regards?
Like they shouldn't set up by the children.
So bodily harm, huh?
Yeah, but I mean, it also kind of brings into that, like, work and use type
stuff. So you have a right to own your body.
Yeah.
And also, they're saying, in the
mind, yes, in mind is ancient. Like, people should be allowed to, like, further use other people and take advantage of people. And
here in that state, so I'll ask you to grasp my please. What else? Any other rights? What rights do we have here in the United States? It's fundamental rights, constitutional rights. If you live in a country, you should be able to participate in what the government does in it. Your citizens, they go on there. Regardless of you pay taxes or not, you're still a citizen. Anyway, symbol of the protest, you ever can get together peacefully, you can walk up to Spring Hills, or walk up down the city hall, that you know, fight and stuff. Damn, like that, you can't.
So we have that Elijah that like the comic epic that they well this is so controversial here, but he's saying he's still over here a lot of times.
You got that. It really, I mean it's this. But speech is so also goes to expression.
Yeah.
This speech is communication. You have the right to communicate. You know, you get careful. You should be in society. But then we say, hey, you know, the company has its own policy. So it goes above the government. The government allows it to do it. So then you say, hey, the NFL is a company. Should Colin Kaepernick be allowed to do that if you are the owner of the San Francisco 49ers? What did you say about Colin Kaepernick? Yeah, what did you say about Colin Kaepernick that you own the team? And you pay him $30 million a year.
I think you might be worried about the image of your team amongst the United States people here, and you might cause an outrage, but then, kind of went back to your ethics and what you believe in. I'd be all for whatever you want to do. Media and
okay. And you say, hey, you know what, I'm all for a common character, and he has, yeah, has the right to express himself. And he sees injustices in society, and this is his way to help us with injustices. And then, say, you hear San Francisco Police Department. He gathers all their family members for a fire department. That's the guy that's in the military, et cetera. And they're like, hey, you know, we're not going to game anymore. Now stay inside. You as a manager, I mean, you as the owner, you just lost 200. What do you do about Colin Kaepernick?
I guess everything is something you do, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. So take it as a company, take it as a lost cost. Yeah. Just keep them on the team. Because you don't want to be persuaded by how the news and media and society is saying how you should operate in this country.
Yeah. I mean, if I shut them down, or if they came off the team, which is showing that we're not really allowing someone to really express himself and me and expose them like that,
Okay. So you throw the water and come out after the death of it. That's what you would do?
Yeah, just throw it in and
so you would restrict him. I mean, obviously that would make a media frenzy too. Yeah, like, hey, why did Colin Kaepernick stay in the locker room during the national anthem while the owner said that not
you're paying him $30 million a year. I mean, you'd have to find a say in it, so that's what I would do.
So you would override his...
I'm paying him when I'm like,
exactly. So yes,
I'm going to control him.
Yeah. And this is what makes it interesting. Everybody has a different perspective. Any other rights? Okay.
That's the prosecutor there.
Yeah.
Everybody should be treated equally under the law, right? I'm worth 150 million, you would be unemployed, so that would be treated differently. Like a problem with sentence right now. And that's probably one of the good response to the one more.
So yeah, I mean another my thought is, you know, as a company, you should, my thing is life is always the same, right? Everything's in the middle, everything's in the middle. But you should always try to be somewhere in the middle as a company. Company cannot totally reflect your religious beliefs. Custom to your tradition. It has to reflect kind of a conscious awareness about what else has been going on in this market, in this industry, in the macroeconomics of this country. Because you still have a fiduciary duty to people involved in the company. You have people who are stakeholders, or stockholders, or shareholders. You have a responsibility towards your employees. You have a responsibility towards the CEO, just like a regular manager, general manager. So I think you should, I like the approach of adaptation. You know, you go in there, you do business, how it's done there. And then you can come back on top, implementing programs, social programs, marketing plans, and working with governments to make things better. Or to just begin the conversation, like, hey, you know, can life be better here in this country? Is what's been going on, like, the way that people actually want to live, or is it because they're restricted to what you go? Most of the time you find that, it's not how people want to live. It's the best company they have in mind. And also in every country is. Yeah, the United States has a high middle class, I know we talked about that. It's a very large, large middle class. People at the top pay the least amount of taxes relative to income. And people in between, which is the majority of Americans, pay all the taxes to all the work. And then the people at the bottom. And the government assistance, or just barely making it. But most other countries around the world have very small middle class. So it's either you're rich or you're poor. It's just very black and white. So then you ask the question, like, well, for the majority of people in here are poor, should we not raise the wage? Should we not give them the best working conditions, should not give them the best this and that. Because maybe through globalization, we'll see how great work we're doing, and they'll start doing it too. Then you make real change. You know, you set a precedent so that people can follow your footsteps. And in turn, you make more revenue off of that in the long run. You know, so you take this short term loss and saying, hey, you're not going to give these people good pay, we give them awesome working conditions, and they're about to provide. Employee housing. For the sake of our long-term objectives, and hey, you know, this country is fertile. This guy, I believe it's going to change in 24 years, and we're going to be the leaders. We're going to be the forefront of this change. So we'll look at some of the benefits and costs. Of operations around the world. Who has got a black market? So let's ask ourselves, what is the benefit of
starting another company in a foreign land, somewhere else in Africa?
What is the corporate benefit to us
here in the United States? You know, we have our headquarters here. How would it benefit? What are some of the benefits?
You need to mark who you know when you were in that access to.
You broaden your market.
You're allowing opportunities to make more money and grow. What else?
So you allow a business to come to overseas and start producing overseas as well? It's going to reduce how far is that effect?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're creating bigger networks. It's good on your products and your services. What else? Think from a pure business or a financial perspective. What is a financial or economic benefit? Starting a new, you know, a subsidiary or a smaller company for us.
Keep the cost of what you need to pay lower wages.
Cell phones, right? Most of them are not made here. They're designed here.
You have to pay over the tax, the corporate tax.
Yeah. Lower taxes, little to no taxes, versus an exorbitant amount of taxes in the United States. Say, hey, I make the same product elsewhere, how much more money are we going to make just due to taxes? 25% versus 1% is $1.1 billion. Relative to this, about foreign exchange. You say, okay, the strongest value of dollars in the world is the British pound, the EU's euro, and the dollar. But if you go to a place where the dollar is valued at $1,000, that's a lot of money. Remember, Tanzania is one of the poorest countries in the world. It's always in like the bottom three. But at one time, their inflation rate, it was like in the billions. So literally, like, a loaf of bread, they start printing out a new amount of bills. You would go buy a loaf of bread on your hand at somebody else for $1 million for a loaf of bread. Yeah. So essentially, then if you are a company, you're like, well, maybe Tanzania, you do an assessment, say, hey, maybe there's some opportunities for getting Tanzania. By the way, we probably can buy the whole country if we wanted to. You know what I mean? So you have to consider those things. Like, hey, you know what? We have so much money, and the inflation rate is so ridiculous that we can buy an entire city, we can buy a town, we can buy a state. We could eliminate any competitors right now to jump on it, as opposed to, like, you know, if the country's fertile. and if it's out, it's going to be 10 to 12 years.
Cost. What are some of the costs? Instead, look on the opposite thing. What's the some of the risks and the costs associated with doing business?
The headquarters is probably your headquarters. You know, your
okay. Okay, so you could just so you're creating a gap. Creating gaps in company, right? Maybe a cultural gap. Maybe this subsidiary is completely different than who we are here. We don't like it. We want to change things. Maybe it's just too far. Maybe there's the language barriers. We just create a gap all over the place. What else?
Maybe the supply chain is too complex.
Whereas before you took 3 steps to get your products or whatever your services to the end consumer, and that takes 100. Look at the cell phone company. Some of those cell phones they probably work in 50 different countries with 50 different parts until you go to the finished product. Right? So you get a processor from Germany, you get a transistor from Taiwan, you get a screen from Korea. You can say, well, how long is it going to take that? Now we're not able to be an early adopter and get it off the market. Right? Now we're going to wait. Now I got to wait. So middle of November, you get the iPhone 7 Plus, Jet Black, 256 gigabytes. Yeah. Wow. That's a very complex supply chain, you know? And you have to create a product like that in X amount of time. What about employment? What are some of the benefits and costs in regards to employment with doing business overseas? What are the benefits?
You might be able to find workers that are more skilled.
Better skilled there.
High volumes of new workers, management type, specializations, and people.
You hire 10,000 people in India, as opposed to just hiring 20 here in the United States. And that is
you might be giving people in other countries opportunities to work that they wouldn't have had otherwise.
Yeah. The direct creation of new jobs. It'll be the first time someone's ever worked in their life, you know. Where you essentially first person to create a position, you know, as opposed to be able to send position style. Well, any cost to it associated with this? Any risk? What's the downside on the point?
I see the downside would be know what you're doing with it.
You may literally have to teach them English, right? So they can call back to the United States and speak to me. And say, well, how much can it cost to train 10,000 people to speak English? And how long is it going to take? And how effective will it be? And will it be better to do it here if you want to?
Also, I want to add that after you can get on your parents' staff. I have to deal with their culture and their
This would be very expensive to do. Anything else? What about competition? Example being China. What if that's already a disaster there? You know, going to China to get cheap labor. It's just too many competitors there. It's just too many, too much competition. And other places might have scarcity for those particular skills outside of China. So China is too competitive. The rest of the world don't have the skills to do this and too costly. So, just do it very long. This is something really kind of outside of the textbook, but I think it's a good thing to learn as a manager having operations overseas, to evaluate or assess, is it worth doing business overseas? That's called a real world evaluation. Real-world evaluation deals primarily with looking at the constraints within a country, such as time, budget, data. Maybe you can't get any data. Maybe you're doing operations. You want to do operations, you can't see them, but you can't get anything on that. So the alternative approach would be the utilization approach, which is essentially saying, hey, I have a good feeling, I have an intuitive feeling that Tanzania is fertile ground. I think there's great opportunities here, but we have very little mathematical metrics to go. This is the opportunity, this is also a complete metrics and constraint. First thing you want to do is planning and scoping. This is essentially what a real CEO will do.
So if your city's already looking at, hey, you know, have a great idea, let's go over to South Africa, it's a great opportunity to do that stuff too. How are we going to approach this? Well, we have to get all this information about South Africa. The first thing we want to do is a use assessment. What is South Africa? What they got? They go on off, it's not really good. Therefore, we'll go. Second is identifying time, budget, and data constraints. As a CEO, you would love to say, once again, there's a great opportunity, I think, here. I have a gut feeling that we can go here and implement this product or this service. But we only have a limited amount of time to do it. We can only allocate a certain amount of money in order to see if it can be done. And the only data we can get is to go through the government. There's really no corporate or economic or monetary companies in its locations that we could reference that. That's step two. This deals directly with addressing the budget constraints. As a CEO, or high-level manager, C-level manager, you're going to look for reliable data. The first thing you will come up with is, hey, what's the government data? The census. Another option will be, hey, let's put people on the ground. Let's go out with questionnaires and surveys and see how we do it. What kind of needs they do? How do people feel? What's the demographic? What's the population of the Asian population? What's the income of this? It's a good one. Third is time constraints. Thank you.
for our drug lab, so the ones not going to see you.
Yeah, yeah.
So who are you, but you don't want to go to your drug lab, so.
Yeah, but then you don't want to be, you don't want to open it, just people to stop.
Yeah. And then if it's the top thing that resonates, they don't, you know, drink by that.
No, I thought this was awesome. This is really good. I don't maybe okay, so here's my recommendation. Create three, what is it you want to do after your
graduation? I'm kind of looking for some future project management, but that's why I struggle because I'm really good at like what I can do. I have all the skills and I just don't know what I should write myself into.
Yeah, so you don't know specifically you know, how I want to work in advertising tomorrow.
I'm very analytical. I like a lot of culture, a lot of people. I'm definitely not a salesperson. But I know I really want to be a job. I want to go to places and travel. So I can deal with it. And I don't consider like talking to people based on that because I'm a face professional.
So, okay, I would say create one specifically for management, and then from each one of these bullet points, pull out something relative to managing or looking at others. And that's it. And eliminate the others that are wrong.
Okay.
You know? And do the same for marketing. Say, well, you know, philosopher, humanitarian, blah, blah, blah. That, to me, is a shift I see in people getting hired to separate themselves from the market.
Okay. So it's like branding yourself.
Kind of branding yourself. But I would do that last to say, make it general, you know, so follow every kind of name that is following yourself. And I mean, that's pretty much it. Education at the bottom, experience at the top, do three that you think you want to go in. And I think it could just be one for strictly management, one strictly for marketing, and a third strictly for more. But I mean, as far as that, you've done everything very good. So I really like the summary. You pretty much hit all the major points and things like that you've done. One of the other things is maybe eliminate one from each and add a measure. So then you can just do one from each place that you work. I mean, I see it here. Yeah, I see it. We go here. But I mean, everything else is great, but I would say throw in one place. Throw in a number for each one. Increase sales, increase projected earnings, anything you can think of, and then you actually get, you just have to know. Quarterly sales and fall, throw in training, some sports. So yeah, I'd say three, and then that way you can find a job. Yeah, yeah. My three resumes, one of them I'm going to go over here. Put that in on this one and then something else.
Okay.
But I think number one is really probably tailored to say first, what do I want to do? So look around and be like, ooh, this is a cool job. You know, like this place, Amnesty International, they have this job going into the county, and bam, there's your third person going out to that. And you're like, all right, I'm not going to wait around here for them. I select like, not 10 from each, but maybe 10 altogether, the different ones that I really want to do, and similar parts. So, if you want to see leadership, marketing is secondary, you just can't go around marketing. So, marketing management also goes hand in hand. Yeah, and I mean, you know, if you finish them, and then you want me to look back at them,
yeah.
And then also, I'll send you the information about the career development.
Yeah, I didn't think that. So
yeah,
I see. Yeah, career development, talking about it.
Okay. I'll send you the email that I sent you. There's like, oh, you know, we two new guys on the roster, and they're exactly those, and, you know, this is not something for things. That's for but I'll send you their information and other ways you can go talk to them too. Salary, you know, a livable salary. I'm going to do something like You know, so it's very difficult to find out. There's no one from this place. They're normally driving all over the universe, you know? So yeah, I my recommendations, do three separate resumes, one page each, keep your summary awesome, maybe do a headline for each one, very general, but something that, you know, stands out, and at least one number of each person. Hey, have you ever thought about the Olympics?
Not that good.
I get really inspired over like the real Olympics. Yeah. Just like, and some of these people seem like normal people who really just put in like 4 or 5 years of work and now they're just the best, you know? But yeah, they're probably not the best, you know, in between. They just want to get
there.
Yeah. But I mean, when I was graduating my bachelor's, I mean, I'm still lost. I don't know what I want to do. I think normally,
especially since I walked up my bachelor's and not really doing something, so I was like,
there's a lot of people. Yeah,
I was like, oh, I've got like less than 3 months.
Yeah. Which is kind of good though. I mean, at least you're competing students. Well, I already put it away. By the time they graduate, they've already got your name out there. You want something to have an internship and kind of be friends with the college. Because, you know, everybody's graduating in May, that's a lot of competition.
I know, it's not happening how that pops up, but it just makes kind of stress right now.
Yeah.
But if you hear of any conversations,
oh, definitely. Yeah, no, definitely. I will,
does not have their own water, so I'm going to help you.
I'm going to help you.
You got your